Well, hello there again, my YouTube friends. On the bench today, we've got a iPod fifth generation touch which needs a new charge port. And it's not just a ordinary charge port. You can see it's one of these big flex cable charge ports with the soldered ribbon cable soldered directly to the unit itself, or its PCB. So he's turned off, so we're going to heat the front up and take the front off and get started. I always like to warm the back up as well, because I find that if you warm the back up and get the case warm, you see people quite often just doing the fronts. And whilst that's okay if you're in and out real quick, if you heat the back up as well, it tends to keep the whole unit quite warm, so you've got a bit more time with the glue melting. Just get my little blade in down there. And just pry them up until you get enough room that you can get like a spudger or something in there without damaging anything. As I say, this one's not been apart before, so I'm not rushing. Just try and get one of me little spudges in there. Never happy having the knives in there, or the metal blades. Spudges are okay though. It's only the plastic you can hear cracking there by the out of the metal housing. It's not the glass or anything like that, I hope. Think I'll have to move on to a metal spudger. Okay, I've just put quite a bit more heat on this. It's been a bit of a pain to get off, but I can still see glue down here at the bottom of the screen, so it's obviously what's holding it on. Okay, I can hear the glue starting to tear now. Sorry, couldn't see. Yeah, as you can see actually where it's stuck, and I've broken a bit of me. Don't worry, it's not the PCB, it's a bit of me plectrum. They're really strong, those clips. Okay, and the ribbon cable is up at the top. Right, for a bit of screen support, I like to use these. They're called bench dogs. Actually, are they called bench dogs? Bench cookies, rather. Bench dogs. Bench cookies, and they're really grippy, especially if you're on a silicon mat. And what I'll do is get two lots, because I don't want that screen to drop backwards. So if I put a couple of them there. You guys are still in shot. You've got to be real careful taking these off, because they are actually switches with circuitry on them as well. This is a sharp blade, so I'm only cutting the glue. Just be careful you don't push the blade too far through, or you will actually shear it off its connection. You can see if you push it out the way there, we've just got glue. I buy these in bulk. I buy them in the thousands. There's the end of that bit that snapped off, or the part that snapped off. So I'll look at them after I've used them. I'll just inspect them all a little bit. And that one can just go straight in the bin, because they're so cheap. As I say, I buy them in the, I think I get like 500 or 1,000 at a time. So you can afford just to chuck them away. Always put your magnetic pad, if you use them, next to whatever you're doing. And you can put the screws, that's why I've got top written on here, you can put the screws on in line. So you know, save you buying those, the special ones for iPhones. They've got little new indicators on where you put all the screws. I just like to use the magnetic pads. Same for phones, really. If I'm not sure where the screws go, or it's something I've not put done before, even if I have done them before, I'll use these magnetic pads so you know that you're putting the screws back in the right holes. You can see there, so basically I'm using that as an outline of a iPad, and you know that's where the screws will be. And there's my 8 screws. So as well as the 8 up and down the sides, we've got 2 down at the bottom here, still connected to this plate. And 2 round this side. So we can take this off. Just be careful of your button contact there. Might need a bit of a wiggle to get this plate off. It sticks sometimes where that top screw goes. That's not a water indicator, guys. Okay, let me just turn this round again. And you see there, all my screws are on the magnetic backboard in the right place or the right order. So I'm just going to take the battery contact off, or the tape that covers it. Okay, I've ripped that, taking that off, but it's not really a problem. You can just use some Kapton tape over it when you put it back on. Sometimes it comes off in, you know, one piece, sometimes it doesn't. Okay, so I've messed this up now, so it's not a problem. I'm just going to take these, take this plastic tape off around the pads, and I'll have to put the pads on separately. Okay, guys, because of I ripped the Kapton tape off and made a mess of it on top, I'm going to do. It's not a problem. It just means that. It's not come off as easy as I thought it would. So basically what that means is we've got these 3 contacts here that need taking off and then resoldering back on once we put the battery back in. You know, this is still, you know, live basically because the battery is connected to it. So we just have to carefully take these pads off. The board's still a bit warm, so if you're doing this, you've got to make sure that the board is still, you know, a little bit warm, just because there's glue under this stuff as well, which is, it can be a pain. Once you keep your iron on there for a sec, you'll see the pad start to come up like that. And we'll move along to the next one. And that's the battery disconnected. Okay, so we'll go back under the other camera now. Okay, so our battery contact is now vulnerable up there, so What I'm going to do is just put a bit of Captain tape under there, just so he can't touch anything short out. It's not down tight or anything like that. It's just so it can't, you know, move around and perhaps touch, you know, the terminals a little bit, you know, on the board down there in any odd positions. So now we have to turn this over and just heat him up. Should be able to do that without stretching them cables any. So basically just heat the back of the thing up because the battery is glued in. This is not the soldering temperature, by the way. This is just, you know, it's hot, but not too hot. It's mainly, you know, you need to consider that more around the screen area than, you know, the back of the case here. But don't cook it because you might damage the battery. Okay, that should be suitable, I think, now for taking batteries out. It is quite hot, that. That's okay though. I use one of these things. I call it the fish. I'm not sure if that's the proper name for it, but I call it the fish. It's like a sort of fine edge for lifting batteries up. Yes, I can feel the glue is actually near enough melted straight away, so I can hear it all coming apart. Don't punch too much stress on the battery, just turn it up gradually. You'll feel and see the glue melt or the thing peeling away without causing it too much stress in bending or anything like that. And then once it comes up, he's free. You can see we haven't caused him too much bother on the back there. That's just where the outer layer has lifted up a little bit, but that's fine. So we'll just put him there to cool off now. Now, even though this little bit looks loose here, don't be inclined to try and turn it back over, because there is actually another little ribbon cable soldered down to this main ribbon cable under there. So, you know, don't be inclined to pull it up. We actually need this little piece here again, so just be mindful of that. We need to keep him safe. Now the whole lock can, well, this part can come out. This is glued in down at the bottom. So just be aware when you're lifting it up, it has got double-sided tape underneath. And he's free. Just need a bit of heat for the silver RF tape. Okay, let's go under the microscope. Okay, so on this ribbon connector now, we've got to just heat it up a little bit. This is just covering the actual contacts. I don't think my tweezers are gripping at the end, guys. That's not good. Okay, I know which ones will. Okay, and there are connections which we have to desolder. So this piece is actually glued down too. So we have to be careful when lifting it up. We can't just like rip it up, because we've got solder, you know, which is bonding it down, and also this pad which is glued to the PCB. So what we need to do is heat the whole, well, this area up, and then get in quick with the soldering iron while the whole board's still warm. I can just put like a ball of solder on the end of my iron and go across there. That should help it come off quite easily while spreading the heat. So next, just a bit of clean up on these pads. And that doesn't look as though it's doing much really. It's picking it up, but I've got some better stuff than that. This is actually flux remover. It's really good for picking up certain adhesives. It basically just melts it. Okay, so that's nice and clean. And I will have to dry that. It doesn't evaporate like IPA. So next it's a bit of flux and low melt solder again. Don't need to be as fussy this time because we've got no contacts that are in danger of being shorted out. So we can just put plenty of this stuff around. I'll leave that little solder blob on there, that'll come in handy in a minute. And now I'm going to put the micro hot air station on, guys, so sorry about the noise. I'll zoom out a bit so you can see doing and make sure we are in focus. I'm just going to use this blade. It's actually a blunt blade, it's not very sharp. And I'm just going to use that under this. Can you see that? I'm just going to use it underneath, not to go right under these contacts, but I'm just going to start lifting up this adhesive pad with that. That's all, lift it up. I'm not cutting or damaging or anything like that. You've just got to be very careful you don't actually cut any of those traces that are in that ribbon. And sometimes, if this low melt does its job, you can actually start lifting up this cable at the same time. What I'm going to do is just show you the other way, and that is use the low melt right the way along these pads to help lift them up. This is what I left the blob on the pads for. Need some more low melt. Okay, that'll do it. Used to be the case years ago where this low melt used to be so expensive, you had to be real careful with it or sparing with it, but nowadays it's quite cheap, so you can just use it pretty easy, free flowing with it, sort of thing. Okay, and that's that. And you can still see we've got all our solder pads down there with little lumps of or stalagmites or stalactites of solder. So that's okay. And we'll go back on the other camera now. And hopefully this ribbon cable should come out now. And sometimes it's better if you put a little something that's not quite that big down there, because you're basically just trying to fold a little bit of this ribbon cable round. And this is what I said before about having this free moving. If you have it free moving, you can get a bit more of an angle. But we're not trying to save this cable, we can actually just rip it off, but it doesn't, it's better if you can just take things out carefully. And that's him, that's the old one. Now we do have to swap a, a couple of things over on this cable, so we need to keep hold of him. We've got one of the one of these things just comes off, so he's just like a supportive bracket, so he comes off and he'll stick back on the new one. There is a bit of glue holding him on. Okay, so we can get our new cable out now. And you can see the bit we have to swap over. Got the microphone, which we have to, sorry, the speaker, which we have to swap. And also this, we have to take this and a little bit of tape off. We can replace that. I've got loads of that copper tape. And also I can replace this this RF shielding as well, because I've got more of that as well. And you can see under there now, under the original one, where, let's get this lifted up a tad. This is just for the, okay, see what I said, don't pull that up. Sorry, just don't pull that up too much, because that, this pad is actually stuck to the speaker, and the speaker connector is actually another ribbon cable that's soldered to the this main ribbon. So we have to take this off and put him on the new ribbon. It's a bit finicky, but you know, it's just the way it has to be done. Okay, so just to take this speaker off, we need to remove a little bit of captain tape. I don't normally keep stuff like that, because I just, you know, put new stuff on when required. So I just want to flatten this ribbon down so it sits nice when I put it on. Because this had adhesive on the top of it, this little piece of flex out of shot here, I'm just putting a bit of IPA on it to clean it just before I solder it back on. And to put him back down, I'm basically just going to stick him straight back on there, and as long as he's reasonably in line, that'll be just fine. So a little bit of flux. And that's that. Just using this to dry the IPA off. And I'm just getting a tiny bit of Kapton. Stick him back on there. That speaker's only got to go over that way, like that, back into its normal position. Right, we've still got sticky on the back of this speaker, sticky tape, so we can just bung him straight back down. And if I can get this RF tape off without needing to cut a new bit, I will. But sometimes it just tears, so it actually came off. It's all right. If you want to stick a new piece on, sometimes it's just a bit of a pain, because you have to just shape it. And then I am going to get the pad, if possible. There's a little pad on the back of there. You can just see him. So we'll try and pick him off as well. Again, you might need a bit of heat, you might not. Yeah, he's not coming off. So, yeah, it's actually split anyway. So what I'm going to do with that is I'm going to get a bit of Kapton tape. All you're going to do is put it over these two ICs here. Just put the Kapton tape over that and just wrap it round, just so these are shielded from touching anything down there. That's all it's for. So I think this little piece will be suitable. In fact, what you can do is stick it down there if you want to, or stick it across this way, just to prevent it anything shorting out. But I'm going to do it like that. Hope you can see there. Trim that off, being careful not to cut anything that I don't want to cut. Like that. I'm going to twist this a little bit so we get him through the gap. And just fold him over, because this is basically your sort of home button, if you like. So that needs to go that side, this needs to go over this side, and that is basically the way it goes back together. So we need to get this in here. We need to fold this up. We can use the fold in this old one as a guide, so we can see where the fold is in that one. And we want this one to fold in a similar position. You can make little adjustments. And you just slot him in. I'm just making sure that that PCB isn't too sharp on the end. In fact, what I'm going to do is I'm going to lift the board up a little bit, because he's not complying as much as I'd like him to. That should give me enough room just to wiggle this in. Okay, and just put that screw back in. I now need to clean up this board. Being very gentle on the pads as to not lift them. In fact, while we're there, I'll just do the battery contact as well. And then we can just clean them up with IPA or flux cleaner or similar. The flux cleaner I use is like, it's a bit like tar and glue remover. It's not the super vicious stuff, it's just general purpose flux cleaner. I don't know the model, I got it in yeah, you see the way it's lifted all that stuff up there? Can you see that? Like a big skin of glue. Once it sort of breaks it down, you can just peel it off in big lumps. You see this little ball of glue. Sometimes you can leave the sticky stuff on this side if you didn't break the tape like I did, but I'm just going to put some Kapton tape over this once it's back together. Just put a bit of the standard stuff on now, just to, because the other, that flux remover does leave a bit of a residue. You have, to put these on, you have two little windows at either end. You can see a spot on the PCB in either end of the window. That is so you can line the ribbon cable up properly. You can actually see where I've scratched the ribbon cable there, where I've been putting it in. I'll have to have a look at that under the microscope, make sure I haven't damaged it. I don't think I have. I think it's just the black coating that's on the top, but I will double check. Right, so we'll go back under the microscope now just to solder this little fella down. If you look inside the little window on the end there, make sure you can see, we've got not only a little square, but a couple of little alignment arrows. And those, that square has to be right in the centre of those little alignment arrows. You can see if we've got them both lined up properly. Let me use a pusher, like so. You might not be able to see the other one. I can see the other one. So you'll have to trust me there. Got those down like that. We can guarantee that each one of those pads, if you look through these little holes, you can see the little pad underneath. I put them out of line and then in line, and when they're in line you can see that the little bit of copper on the board there is actually showing square in that box. So that's how we know we've got him sort of lined up. Also, I was looking at my drag marks there, and you can see I have dragged the top surface off that cable, but I've not gone through to any of the wires. It's basically just like a coating over the actual ribbon cable itself, that, so it'll be fine. If you want to avoid anything like that, all you need to do is take the screws out of the PCB, lift it up before you put the, you know, before you fold the ribbon cable around it. So because we've cleaned our PCB up there, we can now pull this sticker off the other side of the pads, and very carefully before we actually stick it down properly, make sure we are fully in line. Okay, and he is perfect. So that's good. We can stick him down. You can get a tad of movement out of this pad if you need to, but it's best always to try and get him perfect straight away. So what we're going to do is we're still going to push him down, even though he's got adhesive on the other side. As we're soldering him, we're still going to be pushing him down, so we know that the solder is going right through to the right place. And we're going to use this little tipped soldering iron and just go along, doing each little section at a time. You can do it with a thick tip iron and just go right the way across, but you tend to use a bit more solder like that, so want to use as little solder as possible and just put it on precisely. And for this, I'm going to be using my, this is 0.25 millimeter solder, a bit more finicky, but it's just the way I do it. So flux first, don't need loads of it. I'm just going to tack down the ends first. Just doing it like this, I always feel as though there's, I'm getting solder on every single pad and through to the other side. And also I know that I'm not using so much that there's a danger of creating a short underneath. because each time I'm pressing down, I'm just putting a little bit of pressure on each pad. And there we go, guys. It's a bit more tedious doing it the pad by pad way, but it just makes me happier knowing that it's soldered down properly. And to complete that little section, a nice new piece of Kaplan tape. Okay, just onto the battery connector now, because we just want to be able to test this just before we totally build it up. Just need to put a spacer across the phone there, because I don't want this battery to actually sit down properly yet. Tiny bit of fresh solder on each pad. We can't line this up as well, guys, because we've lost somebody cut the all the Kaplan tape off, or the this mask tape, and you know, left it in a right mess. Oops, still got all gluey stuff on there. That's no good. Very poor, Johnny, very poor. There we are, still lined up in our box there. Actually need a bit more solder on there. As my Kaplan tape might not be as thick as the factory battery tape there, I'm just going to put two layers on, and that'll be enough to protect it. Okay, so I'm back after my tea. I've just moved this battery round. I had it folded like that, supported, but it's affecting the camera, so I've just had to fold it out the way a bit there. So I'm just going to make sure my cables are folded over here, and then I'll put my little metal shroud back around this port, and he just normally sort of clips on like so, and then that can go back in the port. Like that, should slide into position, and you can also put your speaker back in, and he should stick in like so, and then we can put a couple of the screws back on, or back in rather. Okay, and then we can stick our battery back down. He just fits in nice and square, like so. Just give him a gentle press, hold everything in place. And now up at the top here, I'm going to put another piece of RF tape, or EMI shielding tape, whatever you want to call it. Because we had some up there originally, so I'll just put it back to the way it was. You know, if anyone sees inside, it looks like I've tried, you know. There we go. Not very straight, but it's okay. And I'll just put a couple around the side so we're lined up. Right, what shall I do with the screen? Shall I just use... I think we'll be alright with that stuff that's left, because it's still really, really tacky, so I'm going to chance that. Okay, and now for the stick down the button. There's a little hole there that the button lines up with. You can see it in the metal. Well, you'll see if you ever do this job, you'll be able to see it. Little tiny screw for the top. Actually, I think on the iPods, these screws are the same length as side screws. Perhaps just the top ones are... I think they have a more flatter head on them. Okay, so let's move my special alignment tool. I've got no screws left over. It's always good. Make sure he still works. I think we are okay to lock this screen down now. So he locks in at the top first, and then you press him round all the way round, hopefully hearing him click in, like so. And then just a little bit of blue tack stuck all over it. And you can see there we've got quite a dirty iPod. Now not so dirty. Come on, boot up little iPod. Sometimes they do take a little while after the battery's been disconnected and everything. And there we go. Touchscreen's still working. Slide to unlock. Greasy fingers, guys, greasy fingers. Still booting up, that's why it's a bit glitchy. Touch. No idea what the password is. Just delete that. Yeah, sometimes they're a bit slow sometimes on after they've been turned off, but yeah, that's fine. Main thing is the charge. So let's see if he charges, because that's what this one wouldn't do. So we're looking at the... Let's turn these lights down a bit. Looking at the little battery symbol in the top corner. And we have a green charge symbol. So that's a good sign. And we have a dong as well, so the speaker's working. So I'll just stick a set of headphones in this now, make sure that's working, and we should be good to go. So I've just put some headphones in this, guys, and it's working fine. So that's the iPod 5th gen, or the iPod 5 with a new charge port and ribbon cable, etc, etc, and all its soldering. And you see the sides are all just as I got them, really. No new marks. Okay, guys, that's the end of the video. I hope you enjoyed it, and I shall see you in the next one. Thanks for watching, guys. Take care.